Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Celebration Community Church. We're so glad to have you with us, whether it's here in our sanctuary or with us online this morning. The best announcement I can make this morning is, although our Reverend Joreen is away this weekend, we are so happy and so blessed to welcome back to be with us the Reverend David Gray. We want to let you know that through your generosity, we were able to send $5,600.50 to Together Rising to help those in the Ukraine. Reverend Swift sent a very kind letter telling them who we were and said, if you're ever in the area, please stop by and see us. The beautiful flowers on the organ are in honor and celebration of Jane and Vicky. 25 years, ladies, is that correct? And what a ride it has been. We want to remind everyone that starting next Sunday, we kick off Holy Week. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday. We encourage you all to be here. And then throughout that week on Monday, Thursday, and then Good Friday, we'll be having services here for both of those days. And then, of course, Easter Sunday, we'll have a 7 and a 10 o'clock service. So please come be a part of all of it. This is the big time in the church year, so we want all of you to come and worship with us during that time. Again, it is great to see all of you on this beautiful day. Indeed, this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Please join me in the call to worship. Spring is breaking forth.
In all the land, new life is happening.
Feel the wonder and power of God's creativity and His energy.
Feel the awe and joy of God's love for us.
Let us worship God with a full sense of joy and expectation.
Let us open our hearts, our spirits, our souls to God's lavish love. Amen.
Let's pray. We come into your presence, O Lord, with so many burdens and concerns on our hearts. Help us to be open to your words of healing and restoration. Bring us closer to you. Enable us to discern your will for us, that we may serve you more faithfully by serving others in need. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please rise as you are able as we join together in worship, singing our opening hymn, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing.
Makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise. They are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild animals will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches, for I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, the people for whom I formed for myself, so that they might declare my praise. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
As I share with our Agape congregation at Broadway, there's no place I'd rather be than right here, right now with each one of you. The reason for that is the way that you care for one another. Because although we come together on Sundays to celebrate each Sunday the risen Jesus, we come together on Sundays to celebrate our fellowship and friendship and communion with one another. We also know that there are members of our fellowship, people who are related to parts of our fellowship, and folks around the world whom we don't know at all, but we still extend God's care to, who are suffering, who are struggling, it may be with physical issues, maybe with emotional issues, it may be with mental health issues, it may be with the fact that it's hard sometimes in this economy to get anywhere, maybe with the fact that sometimes relationships break down. All of these things are concerns of ours today. And so even as we come to worship, we come remembering those of our fellowship, and those outside of it who need our prayers. As a recent recipient of your prayers, I can tell you how important that is. So if you will look in your order of worship, you will see the prayers and concerns of our congregation. And I invite you to take a moment and identify one or two of those and give those to the Lord as I lead us in prayer together. Let us bow our heads. God, we come with a mixture of both hope and despair, of both anticipation and fear. Because we carry into this space not only our dreams of what you will do in our lives and how we can contribute to your dream, we also carry into this room things that have worked on us and hurt us and burdened us this week. And God, we know the best place to place those things is in your hands. Trusting in your goodness and in your grace. Giving over to you those things that we cannot control, but sometimes must merely endure. And so God, this morning, I ask you to look at each of the names and each of the concerns that are listed in our order of worship. I ask you to look into all of our hearts, at the things that we carry right now. And God, through your grace, I invite us to set those burdens down, trusting that you will pick them up, that you will bring healing, that you will bring hope, that you will bring vision for a future which is better than the one that some experience now. God, we place into your hands international concerns, war, famine, disease. God, we place into your hands those concerns within our own society, for those who are under attack for who they are, for whom you've created them to be. God, we lift up to you our friends and family who are struggling, and we trust in your goodness, in your mercy, and in your grace. We believe we can do this because of the good work of Jesus in our lives. Amen.
Please rise as you're able for reading from the Gospel of John. Six days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Mary took a pound of Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She brought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." This is the gospel of grace.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Sorry, I need to gather myself there a moment. Choir, that was incredible. Thank you so much. That was just wonderful to speak with you. For more reasons than I can count, I'm glad to be back with you this morning. I want to recognize somebody who's here with me. She's seated in the back because she's become a Baptist the last 3 years and we're Baptist. And it's, yeah, I'm just surprised she became that Baptist. Catherine Godby, Reverend Dr. Catherine Godby. Catherine, wave your hand, please. She has to read these sermons and then she actually comes and listens to them, which is an act of love and devotion that I frankly don't deserve, but I'm grateful for. And you've had the opportunity to hear her from this pulpit in the past. And she's the better preacher in the family too, but I probably shouldn't have said that. At least not in front of y'all. I am grateful to be here this morning. For those of you who don't know, and I know most of you do, about 9 weeks ago I had a heart attack, which sort of spoiled my plans for the next year, which they tend to do. But I'm grateful that I'm able to be back with you. And I need to say to you, thank you. You are the members of my other church family. And you have given me so much over these last 9 weeks. You know, when you've ridden a bike for years, you've eaten right, you've gotten your sleep, you don't expect to finish a 47-mile bicycle ride with a heart attack that the doctor says should have killed you. That, as I said, certainly put a dampener in all of my plans. But that heart attack opened me to receiving overwhelming grace and mercy from all of you. From your cards, your texts, your emails, Facebook posts, your constant prayers. And I might not have known everybody who was praying, but I can assure you that I know that you were praying because I'm able to stand with you here today. Those prayers carried Catherine and our children and me through what could have been a frightening time. And I want to tell you this, the best medicine that I have received is the knowledge that we are not alone.
Amen.
And I think that's the most important message that as a church we carry to each other and to our community. You are not alone. And I give thanks to God for that. But I'm not grateful for the heart attack. I've been asked, what have you learned from this? And I'm thinking, oh, come on. I got to go through rehab, plus I have to learn? No, I'm not interested in doing that. What I have learned is this. They don't let you do anything fun. I still can't ride a bicycle. Well, I might have cheated the other day. Just don't tell my cardiologist. They don't let me drive a car, although I do back in and out of the driveway. And I'm grateful for my driver this morning, who also happens to be my wife. And here's the worst thing. They don't let you eat good food anymore. I swear, if I never see another bowl of oatmeal, and I eat one this morning, it'll be too long. I was told I could rest. Oh, come on. I could watch television, take really short walks. If I got really bored, I could read. Well, I fooled them there because I do like to read. And so I picked up some light reading in the last 8 weeks. I'm sharing you the titles of some of the things that I've read. The Earth is Weeping. The Heartbeat of Wounded Knee. Healing Haunted Histories. To Hell and Back. The End of Everything. Those all seem to be appropriate titles after a heart attack, right? And since those aren't light enough things to read, I just recently finished a history entitled Bloodlands. Boy, doesn't that sound enticing? Sounds like an AMC miniseries with zombies and things like that. This is actually a history by Timothy Snyder, and it's about Ukraine and Poland and the Baltic states during the period between 1933 and 1945, during the time when the Nazis and the Stalinists murdered over 14 million people. Yeah, that's not the most right, inspiring reading I've come across, but I thought getting current events, it's probably not a bad thing to read again. And I came across one passage from that book that stuck out at me. Let me share this with you. It is easy to sanctify policies or identities by the deaths of the victims. It is less appealing but more morally urgent to understand the actions of the perpetrators. The moral danger, after all, is never that one might become a victim, but that one might be a perpetrator or a bystander. Now, what does that quote have to do with this simple story from the 12th chapter of the Gospel of John? We've read the text a moment ago, but let me share it with you again. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, home of Lazarus, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Lazarus and his sisters hosted a dinner. Martha served, and Lazarus was among those who joined him at the table. Then Mary took an extraordinary amount, almost 3/4 of a pound, of very expensive perfume made of pure nard. She anointed Jesus' feet with it, then wiped his feet dry with her hair. The house was filled with the aroma of the perfume. Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, complained, "This perfume was worth a year's wages. Why wasn't it sold and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He carried the money bag and would take what was in it. Then Jesus said, "Leave her alone. This perfume was to be used in preparation for my burial, and this is how she has used it. You will always have the poor among you, but you won't always have me." Now, this story is about a dinner, a blessing, a complaint, and a rebuke. Kind of like Thanksgiving at some of our houses. For such a simple story with no miracle and no crowds, there's an awful lot going on in here. They're the three main characters: Jesus, Mary, and, forgive me, the mustache-twirling villain Judas. Because the writer of the Gospel of John, in all his parenthetical comments, certainly sets Judas up for his fall. Now, when we hear a story, we tend to identify with one of the characters. In this story, we like to identify with Mary. Admittedly, I tend to identify with Martha. I've always been angry that she's always stuck in the kitchen. Mary's out there chuckling and gabbing with everybody else. But Martha doesn't play a role in this one. Mary looks like a hero. And when we preach this story, when I'm standing up here looking at you, I want you to identify with Judas, because that's how I get you to come down the aisle at the end of the sermon. As I look at Timothy Sire's quote, though, out of the book, I want to invite us to identify with both of them, with both Mary and Judas, because there is some of them in each one of us. The whole reason for this family dinner was to celebrate the raising of Lazarus. If you look at the Gospel of John in the preceding chapter, that's where that story happens. And those of you raised in the church remember that. Lazarus had died. He'd been dead several days. Jesus was delayed getting to him. The sisters were pretty upset about that. Martha said if you had been here, he wouldn't have died. That's pretty damning. Jesus wept. The only record we have of him crying is standing in front of Lazarus' tomb. And then he calls Lazarus out and brings him back to life. Now, Jesus was like family to these folks. He spent time in Bethany with these two sisters and their brother. And so, in a way, this was sort of a homecoming for him. Combine that with the fact that they were celebrating Lazarus' raising, and it had the potential to be quite a party. Now, I have to admit, the raising of Lazarus from the dead is something that I can slightly identify with these days. And it was a tipping point for some people, because word got back to the leadership in Jerusalem that Jesus had done this. And they realized, this is a threat we can no longer ignore. This man is going to draw attention, and he's going to threaten our position and our privilege. For others, the raising of Lazarus was meaningful in that it said that this person, Jesus, is God's anointed. And it's clear that Mary thought that, because she anointed him. So she spent a year's wages. Think about that for a moment. Judas said you can get a year's wages for this. Okay, probably. She probably bought it on discount, but still, that's a lot of money in an era where people didn't have a lot of money. And she's got this perfume, and she spills it on Jesus' feet. Now, this story is similar to stories in the Gospels of Luke and Matthew as well, where a prostitute, a known prostitute, comes to Jesus during a dinner and pours it on his head. Are these the same story? I have no earthly idea. They're similar. And one of the things that they have in common is that Mary, this other woman, take an action to express their love for Jesus, their gratitude for Jesus, in a way that was considered shameful for them to do. Mary's act was an act of the heart. It was gratitude for Lazarus. It was awareness that Jesus was in danger. There was an undertone to all of that. I mean, Jesus said it when he said, "She's anointed me for burial." It was an expression of love. And it was a transgression of the appropriate boundaries for women. She should have been in the back serving like her sister did. And her act seemed shameful to the men who were around her. And yet Jesus commends her for it, because her act was an act of great honor. Now, Judas is the antithesis of Mary. Now, I want you to identify with him for a moment. And that's why it is important to try to understand him. I imagine that Judas was appalled by Mary's behavior, not so much for his expressed reasons, but because her action violated his sense of honor. Mary's place was to serve the meal, not anoint Jesus. I imagine his understanding of his place as one of Jesus' disciples and as a man in his society was threatened by what she did. Just as the raising of Lazarus threatened the powerful of Jerusalem, so her act of gratitude for Lazarus' life threatened Judas' place in the world. Here he was confronted by a household that couldn't control its women or its money. So he believed he had to speak up. Judas' concern was expressed in the way that we express our resistance to change that will upset our comfortable place in it. We can't afford it. So Judas, who couldn't care less about giving money to the poor, Judas' status and honor depended on his ability to control the purse for Jesus and his followers. To extravagantly use money on perfume threatened his ability to profit from the money that he controlled. In an attempt to maintain his honor, he acts dishonorably, as the gospel writer reminds us that he is indeed a thief. Now, during my recovery, while not reading books, I skimmed through, should I admit this? Twitter. Don't tell anybody I've said the truth, okay? Because Twitter is sort of dishonorable, right? It's a waste of time. Yeah, to some degree it is. Very entertaining, though. And if I hadn't been scrolling through Twitter this week, I wouldn't have found this gem of an article from Inc. magazine. Because Inc. magazine is not exactly the kind of thing that I normally read. Let me read this article to you. This is really good. Wayne Pankratz, remember his name, a top executive at an Applebee's franchise chain, sent a blast email to his colleagues this month, crowing that raising gas prices were an advantage for the chain. He reasoned that cash-strapped people would have no choice but to take food service jobs, even if the chain lowered its price, its wages, which he encouraged his colleagues to do. Now, the email made its way onto the internet, where it quickly became a major embarrassment for Applebee's and the franchise holder for 121 Applebee's and Taco Bell franchises, and where Pankratz just happens to be the executive director of operations, at least for now. It's easy to see why people were angered by Pankratz's message. He said, "Most of our employee base and potential employee base lives paycheck to paycheck. Stimulus payments and pandemic employment payments have both ended, leaving them with reduced incomes just as prices are rapidly rising. This benefits us," he wrote. "It will force people back into the workforce." And he suggested, Applebee's would further benefit from the strain on other businesses, especially mom-and-pop stores. Faced with higher prices, these businesses would face an unpleasant choice of either raising prices, cutting employee hours, or lowering wages. Pankratz wrote, "Some businesses will not be able to hold on. This is going to drive more potential employees into the hiring pool." He noted that in the current economic climate, Applebee's employees will likely need second jobs to make ends meet. Rather than seeing this as a good reason not to lower wages, He instead tells restaurant managers to get scheduling done early so they can plan their other jobs around yours. And then, in a priceless bit of irony, he writes this: most importantly, have the culture and environment that will attract people. I don't know what's going to happen as a result of this email, but I suspect that Mr. Pankrantz may soon need one of those second jobs. The tightening of the workforce threatens his position in the economy. If others have more, then he will have less. Sort of like Judas. In the meditation of preparation, I hope you had the chance to read that for a moment. It probably seemed a little kind of out there without context. It's a quotation from an educator by the name of John Kozol, who's worked for years with children and with poor children and about their desire to learn. And in this quote, he's responding to the argument that the only reason to fund education is to be sure that students develop the skills necessary to enter the workforce, that they learn how to do things and fix things. And in response to that, he says, you know, why don't we invest in them simply because they're children and deserve to have some fun before they die? Why not invest in their gentle hearts as well as their competitive skills? This is extravagant thinking about education. Sort of like Mary. I think that when we begin to identify with Judas in this story, we understand that we may be one or two choices ourselves from becoming much like him. Like Judas complaining about how much money the perfume would bring on the open market, we may begin viewing others instrumentally. Then we act as if the only value people have is the value that the market assigns to them. Then we begin to criticize the generosity of others in order to avoid being generous ourselves. Then we claim that scarcity and austerity are the only serious and hard-headed approaches to the needs of others. Then we interpret the words of Jesus about the poor always being with us as an excuse to do nothing about the poor, instead of using his words as a challenge to find ways to treat the poor among us as extravagantly as Mary. When we identify with Mary, we run the risk of looking silly, of looking out of place, of not being serious. I mean, imagine that, pouring that much perfume on a man's feet. I mean, my goodness, if we identified with Mary, we might choose to pay others enough that they can afford a place to live, food on the table, and medical care. We might choose to understand that there is no honor in stinginess and no shame in extravagance. We might experience the joy of living with our whole hearts. Here's what I believe the lesson of the story is. Jesus invites us to spill expensive perfume, to be extravagant, to be generous, to wholeheartedly care for the poor and for each other. This is what we do in the pastoral prayer when we invite ourselves to look at the names on that home, on that order of worship, that we wholeheartedly care for them in our praying as well as our doing. The Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians invited the people in that church to open their hearts wide to each other. And I believe that is the invitation of this story: to open our hearts wide to one another. This has been my life's journey, because trust me, I am a Judas. Oh, I'm not a traitor particularly, but I am the one who goes, we can't afford that. I am the one who goes, we should have done that differently. I would have done that differently. And throughout my life, God has placed people and opportunities in them that give me the chance to decide, do I say, let's sell the perfume, or do I say, let's spill the perfume? And the joys that I have found in my life have come when I've learned to spill. It hasn't always been easy. I still pinch pennies. But I have learned, like Mary, to begin to open my heart. hearts with me. Amen.
Amen.
Please find the red book at the end of your pew and sign in to share your attendance with us today. Should you have a prayer, concern, a change of address, or phone number, indicate that in the book. Now, let's pray together. Generous God, you tenderly care for each person you have created. You miraculously restore people to health and shine light into the lives of those who are discouraged. Guide us so that we will not regard others according to their outward appearances, but seek to find your love in their hearts. We dedicate our offerings and ourselves to the work of your kingdom on earth until Christ returns in glory. Amen.
One way's gone, Lord.
The ancient hymn reminds us that Jesus did not think equality with God something to be clung to, but instead he emptied himself and took on the form of a servant, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God. We gather today at this table, like Christians throughout the world, to experience the real presence of Jesus, to remember the gift of Jesus, and to share that gift with one another. On the night before he died, Jesus sat down at dinner with his friends. At the dinner, he took a loaf of bread. He blessed it, and then he broke it into pieces, and he handed the pieces of bread to his friends. And he said to them, "Just as I give you this bread, so I give you my life." At the end of that meal, he took a cup. He filled it with wine, and he gave thanks for it to God. And he said, "This cup represents a new way of living, of loving one another, of following me. Each time you eat this bread and drink this cup, remember me." We come forward to serve communion to one another. We invite you to come as you're able in order to receive the bread and to receive the cup. us pray. The bread and the cup, through Jesus' presence, draws us together in communion with one another and with followers of Jesus from throughout the world and through all of history. May this encourage us, strengthen us, and fill us with joy. Amen.
I invite you to stand as we close in worship together, singing our closing hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
Children, God's beloved family, called by God to live a life of generosity and grace. And so in a land where we so easily close our eyes, in a land where we so easily shut our ears, in a land where we so easily close our hearts, open your hearts wide. To God, to one another, and to the world, and let them know of the goodness and grace and generosity of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen.